Majority of our time talking about unlocking the unstoppable you. And I just want to thank those of you who have shown gratitude and appreciation for the word and told me that it really made a difference in your life. And we want to go part two this Sunday, same topic, unstoppable, but here's where we do it a little differently. It's entitled, I Put the Un in Stoppable. Why don't you just say that with me? Say, I put the un in stoppable. Oh, I'm excited about this. We want to go to 1 Peter 2, 9 through 10. You've already read it, and you did some great reading. Your reading is getting better and better and better, and I want to commend you for that, amen? When we started reading together as a group, I had some concerns, amen? But you all are pulling it together beautifully. And you read 1 Peter 2, 9 through 10, and I want to make sure you understand that we have Peter here penning this particular pericope of Scripture because he's talking to the Israelites, who are the people of God, but at this point in time, they were known as the scattered ones. I just need somebody to say the scattered ones. They were called the scattered ones because they were running from their enemies. They had been divided by their oppressors. And at this point, when Peter is speaking to them, they have just begun to accept Christ as the Savior and the Lord of their lives. And Peter informs them that now you have a new identity. I don't know if anybody understands the power of having your identity upgraded, but when we give our lives to Christ, I want you to understand this: you get an upgrade in your identity. 1 Peter 2 and 9, he points out a couple of things that I just want to point out, and I want you to jump with me really quick. Number one, he says, you are a chosen generation. Tell your neighbor, you're chosen, not frozen. All right, what does that mean, Pastor? Well, number one, if there's somebody that's chosen, that means there were other options. Oh, my God. And I need you to fathom this, Freedom Church, because I thought about this last night. This means that God chose you just like he chose his son Jesus to be the Savior of the world. Amen. Now, that should have hit you really strongly if you really thought about what I just said. God chose you just like he chose his son Jesus. Now, you know, like I know, God could have chose somebody else that might have been a little bit better than me. Come on, somebody. Come on, we don't always say the right thing. We don't always do the right thing. Come on, somebody. Even after salvation, we still need some work. And God saw everything that you were going to do that was against his will, that was outside of his word. He saw every sin that you would commit before you were even born. And God said, I still choose you. I'm trying to build you up today. I dare somebody to stick your chest out and say, God wants me. If don't nobody else want me. Tell your neighbor, you've been chosen. Now, the reason why you should be a little more excited is because God always chooses winners. I'm getting excited early in my sermon. Can I get a witness somewhere that knows God always chooses winners? What do you mean, Pastor? God always chooses winners where he's never chosen a loser. He chose Jesus. Did Jesus win? Boy, he won hands down. You know everything they did to Jesus, and we'll talk more about it next Sunday. But they did a lot to Jesus to keep him from being victorious. They did a lot to Jesus to keep him from succeeding, but he still succeeded. Why? Because God chose him. You don't understand. There's a great power in you because God chose you. And you should not, let me say this, and this is not in my notes, but it's in my spirit. Don't let anybody who didn't choose you make you think you're not worthy to be chosen. Let me just slide that in, and that ain't even in my notes. Sometimes we will think because somebody else didn't choose us that we're not worthy to be chosen. I'm telling you, some folk just don't know how to choose right. Amen, somebody. Some folk don't know how to choose right. And later on, they wish they'd have chose you, but then you done moved on to something better. Amen. Amen. Say, God always chooses winners when they look like losers to everybody else. Give me a little more volume, Mac. I feel good early in my sermon. He chose Jesus, and Jesus looked like a loser to everybody. Come on, they were spitting on Christ. It looked like a loser, man. They was beating him and calling him out of his name. They snatched his clothes off him. They put a crown of thorns on his head, and they put nails in his hands and nails in his feet. And the whole time, he's looking like a loser. See, sometimes you don't understand that your strategy for winning is looking like a loser. Come on, somebody. Sometimes you just got to be quiet as you're going through. Some of y'all tell too much, too early, too soon to too many people. And sometimes you just got to let them think you're losing. I wish I had a church in here. Let them think you ain't going to make it. Let them think you about to give up. Let them think that you are struggling. Sometimes I look like I'm losing, but I'm winning, and you don't even know it yet. Why? Because God always chooses winners. Can I go a little deeper? Do you know the word Christian means to be Christ-like? Do y'all really know that? And I don't know if we can embrace that today fully, but I would like for you to embrace that. To be a Christian means to be like Christ. That means to be fearless like Christ. That means to be focused like Christ. But catch this, it means to be unstoppable like Christ. 1 Peter 2:9, I got to go, amen, says you are a royal priesthood. Now, I know y'all know about crown royal. Let me tell you about royal priesthood. Amen, somebody? Somebody say royal. Come on now, that's sour apple. Come on, come on, say royal. I ain't got no church in here, amen, somebody. Look, you ain't hollering all year. You holler when I say sour apple. Boy, you need to get saved, amen, somebody. Somebody say royal priesthood. Royal priesthood. God says we're royal priesthood. What does that mean, Pastor? Why is that good news? Well, number one, you got to understand what it means to be royal. Webster says royal means to be of kingly ancestry. See, sometimes we allow the places that we were born to dictate how we see ourselves. Now, God says if you were born in a low place, understand that you got some kingly ancestry running through your veins. I'm talking about you are directly connected to the Savior of the world. But then he says, not only are you royal, but you are the priesthood. Now, some of y'all will push that away because I ain't trying to be no preacher. It don't mean you're a preacher. No, 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 no. Royal priesthood means you are of holy heritage. Catch this, freedom. You're of kingly ancestry and you're of royal heritage. What that means is that you are somebody. What it also means is this is what the devil sees when he sees you, which might explain why he's bothering you when you feel like you ain't got nothing worth being bothered about. Do I have anybody that's always been attacked by the devil and you've never been able to figure out why the devil would even bother you? Seems like every time you turn around, the devil's always on your neck. He's always on your back. He's always messing with you. It's because when he looks at you, he sees the royal priesthood that is in you. See, here's what I need to tell you today. The number one thing that makes you stoppable, and I'm talking about being stoppable, is you not knowing who you really are. I've seen people make bad decisions because they didn't know who they really were. Okay, stay with me if you can. I've seen people marry the wrong person because they didn't know who they, I didn't want to say it, but God told me to say it. Amen, somebody. See, sometimes y'all will say yes to relationship just because you don't know who you really are. And then 5 or 10 years later, once you figure out who you are, you'll say, I'll never say yes to that again. That was beneath me. That wasn't worth my time. Do I have anybody that's finally starting to realize who you really are in this world? Man, before I realized who I really was in this world, I was trying to be like everybody else. Before I realized who I was in this world, I used to beg people to spend time with me and beg people to pay me attention. And I felt bad when I was alone. Then when I figured out who I really was, I said, you know what? I'm the blessing. Amen, somebody. Come on, somebody. I'm the gift. Come on, somebody. And sure, some people are going to say you think too much of yourself, but that's all right. They just don't know who they are. Somebody say, I am somebody. Because God chose me. But until you figure this out, you're always going to be stoppable. See, knowledge of self determines everything else. Oh, my God. Let me walk around heaven for a few minutes. Can I say that again? Knowledge of self determines everything else. Why don't you say that with me? Say knowledge of self determines everything else. Everything, Pastor? Everything. Which is why it's important and imperative that you be very careful who and what you listen to. I'm going to pause here for a few minutes. Tell your neighbor, be very careful of who and what you listen to. Look at the picture on the screen. There's a man climbing a mountain. And he's climbing it because he's got knowledge of self. And you see three individuals who have a chain attached around his waist. And more importantly than the chain are the things that they're saying. One is shouting, You're average. Another one is shouting, stop. You can't be great. Give up. And another one is shouting, you've changed. I stopped by to tell somebody that you're supposed to change. Amen, somebody. Something is wrong if somebody hadn't told you you're changing. Amen, somebody. Something is wrong if you still got the same group of friends you had 5, 10, 15 years ago. Oh, it's quiet in there now. And you ain't got nobody new in the mix, nobody smarter, nobody intelligent, nobody aggressive, nobody succeeding. Last Sunday, we saw two blind men who followed Jesus together. You say, well, Pastor, what does that mean? That meant that even though they were blind, they had goals. Amen, somebody? Even though they were blind, they worked together to better the situation. And sometimes the greatest decision you got to make in life is who you're going to be connected to. Oh, my God. Who you're going to allow to speak into your life. And you've heard me say this before, mother. Everybody can't speak into my life. Had I listened to those people and never stepped out and did what God called me to do, I would not have half the things I have today. Sometimes you got to ignore your naysayers, because sometimes your naysayers are player haters. Good God Almighty. And sometimes they're just speaking out of their own experience. You have to tell people, just because you couldn't do it, don't get mad at me. Don't mean I can't do it. And catch this for those of you that have tried and failed. I found out that just because you failed don't mean that you will not excel or exceed. Sometimes you just got to keep on doing. Be careful who you listen to. Now, I've been told over and over again, Eric, I'm a dangerous person. I've been told over and over again, Pastor Troy is a dangerous man. Sometimes I ask them, coach, why you say that? They say, because, man, you have people believing they can do anything. You have people believing in themselves. You have people stepping out on faith. You've got that ability. I say, well, you need somebody like that in your life who can push you when you won't push yourself. Some of y'all need somebody to encourage you. Some of y'all need somebody not to take your excuses and not to accept your BS. And I'm going to say BS. You figure out what that means. It don't stand for Bible study, just so you know. You need somebody in your life that does not agree with you. I tell men all the time, marry you somebody that's going to challenge you. And I'm not going to get a lot of claps from brothers on that, because sometimes we as men do not like to be challenged by women. But I found out a strong man can handle a challenge from a strong woman. My wife challenges me from time to time, and it really do make me strong. What? Make me pray too. Amen, somebody. Sometimes she push them buttons and I'd be like, well, if it wasn't for the Lord, I'd slap the... Y'all pray for me now. But I wouldn't trade her for anything in the world, because she challenges me. She doesn't always agree with me. Sometimes she forces me to explain why I want to do this, that, and the other. She presses upon me to step up to the plate to be the man that I say I want to be. And I thank God that I've got a woman like that in my life. Some of you men could do a whole lot better if you stopped running with these pushover sisters. Who fill your head so you can pay their light bill. I wish I had a church in here. No, she's not going to tell you the truth. You paying the light bill, dummy. So she's going to tell you great, and she's going to tell you amazing. She's going to tell you all night long. And you know, good time where you ain't all night long. Somebody say, be careful. Y'all so crazy over here. Say, be careful.
Who?
And what? You listen to. Now I'm going to challenge you to trust me. Say, Father,
send me
people who will challenge me. Give God praise. You already said it. Pastor, what this got to do with being unstoppable? That's how you get to be unstoppable. You're able to be challenged without falling to pieces. Jesus spent 3 years, Pastor Tish, with the original disciples. Somebody say 3 years. I asked myself, why did he spend 3 whole years with the original disciples? And God said back to me, he spent 3 years so that they could see and be around somebody who was unstoppable. See, sometimes you got to be around somebody that thinks higher than you. You got to be around somebody that challenges your thinking. I've been teaching and preaching and helping people fathom the idea of purchasing vehicles with cash. I'm not going to give me an amen because I know that bothers some people. I'm not anti-payment. You do what you want to do. Nothing wrong with making payments on a vehicle. Let me be clear so I don't lose you. But I've been challenging people. I've been teaching them the benefits of struggling for a season. Driving that old beat up for a while. Saving your money as long as you can. And then buying something cash. I say the benefits of it are you don't have that monthly payment. And the money that you save from not having the monthly payment, you're able to take care of anything you have to do when you have to get the car fixed. And I just throw it out there. It's not for everybody. I understand it's not for everybody. But I've got a couple of people who've been listening to me. One of my brothers sent me a picture last week, and it was a picture of a car. I said, okay, what is this? Then there was a text that followed it. He said, bought this straight cash, homie. I say, boy, hey, boy. See, some of y'all ain't clap. Yeah, you're like, ugh. See, if you understood why that's important, because the same person who sent me that text message when they first got to this church didn't have two nickels to rub together and didn't have a pot that you can fill out the rest of that one. The same brother, his family's ideal of going out was going to Family Dollar. I wish I had a church in here. But because they've taken the word of God and applied it, amen. And everything I preach ain't for you. I get it. But something I say ought to be for you. Amen. Now, what are you telling me? Some of y'all need to get you a new posse. Some of you got to get some folks in your circle that challenge the way you think. You got to get some folks in your circle. I see this. That stretch your belief. Some folk that tell you, you know, you can do better. Some folk that tell you, no, you can have better. Some folk that tell you, no, I see greatness inside of you. And you be like, who, me? Yeah, you. But see, your haters ain't gonna never pump you up. Those that are in competition will never build you up. So get you somebody that don't mind seeing you blessed. I wish I had a church in here. Jesus spent how long with these brothers? 3 years. So that they could be around somebody who was unstoppable. Why? Because this attitude is contagious. I'm telling you guys, this attitude of being unstoppable is contagious. Now, it took them, Mother Oliver, 3 years to go from being stoppable to unstoppable. I'm about to say something. Please receive me. It took them 3 years to go from being stoppable to unstoppable, which might suggest why the devil won't let you stay in church long enough for you to be transformed. I'll clap for myself. Some of you don't understand if you would just drop an anchor and hunker down and stick with ministry, stick with church, stick with being faithful. Over time, you will be a brand new person. Over time, you'll see God doing great things in your life. But you done joined 5 different churches in 7 different years. You do the math. They had to stay with Jesus for 3 years. Now, I know they had disagreements. We see in the Bible they didn't always understand everything he said. But I got to salute these disciples. They stuck with him for 3 years. And at the end of 3 years, he turned them loose on the world and said, take the gospel to the world and to every city. Why? Because they became unstoppable. Tell your neighbor, that's 1,068 days of listening. 1,068 days of learning. 1,068 days of lessons. And you think you're going to get stronger being in and out of church. I ain't going to get many claps because some of y'all are guilty. At some point, you've got to get faithful. At some point, you got to stick with Jesus. At some point, you got to say, I'm going with Jesus all the way, come hell or high water. I'm going to stick with him until my change comes. I'm not going nowhere. I'm not going nowhere. I'm not going nowhere because I am his disciple. Tell your neighbor, be very careful. Who and what you listen to. Tell them because most demons have only one mission. I'm about to say something going to bless somebody. Say it again. Most demons only have one mission. Say, guess what it is? Check this out. Well, you didn't have to say that, but I appreciate it. You with me now. That's when you with the pastor. The one mission that every demon has are distractions. I can't rush through this because some of y'all gonna get healed today. I'm about to write a prescription for what ails some of y'all. His mission is distractions. What do you mean, Pastor? So you'll never be unstoppable as long as you are still distractible. You got to stop being fooled by the devil's hocus pocus. You got to be able to see the distraction and say, you know what? I got to keep my eyes on the prize. Amen, somebody. I got to stay focused like a locust. I can't be deceived by the devil's hocus pocus. Why? Because the last time I was distracted, I lost too much time. The last time I was distracted, I lost out on my miracle. The last time I was distracted, I didn't get everything God was going to do for me. I cannot be distracted in this season. And the devil is a master distractor. Here's why. Because the more the devil believes that you will quit, the more he'll try you. Some of y'all need to hear me today, because the devil ain't trying all of us on the same level. I'm telling you now, the devil working overtime on some of y'all. I'm talking about from the time you wake up to the time you lay down, the devil is hot on your track. When you go to work, he's there. I wish I had a church. When you get home, he's there. Come on, somebody. Sometime when you come to church, he'll be right there waiting on you. He's on your heels because the devil believes you will quit. And as long as the devil believes you'll quit, he'll keep on trying you. Here's what God told me to tell us, Fred. His faith in his tactics are greater than his faith in your commitment. Good God Almighty. Did y'all catch that freedom? Slow it down, Pastor, because they need to hear that. The devil's faith in his tactics are greater than his faith in your commitment. So he keep on trying you because he's gotten you to quit before. Here's the danger with quitting. It can become a... I love y'all today, man. I love y'all today. It can become a habit. And I got people in this room that you don't need to be delivered from nothing else but quitting today. You have started and stopped too many times in your life. You were going to go to school and you quit. Be faithful and you quit. You were going to start tithing and offering and you quit. You cannot start and quit and expect to and expect God to give you what he promised. Tell your neighbor, stop quitting if you want to qualify. Can I go deeper? See, he's not going to stop trying you until he, I'm talking about the devil now, until he's absolutely convinced that you're unstoppable. I didn't understand that all the things I had gone through when I was suicidal, trying to commit suicide by the time I was 25 years old, had tried it 3 times, depressed, overly depressed, angry and violent and would start and stop. I didn't realize that all the stuff I had gone through in my life was because I had not convinced the devil that I was unstoppable. As a matter of fact, I had actually convinced the devil that I was stoppable. So whenever I said I was going to do something, he would always come against me. And honestly, before I got where I am today, 9 times out of 10, I would stop. And I would stop and make excuses like, it's just too hard. I would stop and make excuses like, well, I wouldn't stop if somebody would help me. I would stop and make excuses like, well, you know, it's just hard out here for a black man. And every time I made an excuse, God said, that's your problem right there. You keep making excuses and you're never going to execute your vision until you make up in your mind that you're not going to stop no matter what comes your way. And you have to teach the devil that I am unstoppable. Some of you don't understand that the devil is your student. Oh, my God. He's not your master, he's your student. But if you don't teach him that you're unstoppable, he becomes your master and you become his student. What are you telling me, Pastor? You got a mission to convince the devil that this time you ain't gonna quit, that this time you ain't gonna give up, that this time you ain't gonna turn back. And I know the bottom's gonna fall out. When the bottom falls out, learn how to levitate. Amen, somebody. When the bottom falls out, hang on to the wall. Amen, somebody. But what you ain't gonna do, you ain't gonna quit this time, because if you quit, you cannot qualify. Good God Almighty. Somebody say, he preaching to you. They ain't like that. Amen, somebody. Somebody say, distractions. Can I go a little deeper, Ella Watkins? If you can be distracted, you can be denied. Somebody need to catch that right there with one hand. If you can be distracted, you can be denied. What are you telling me, Pastor? Don't ever let the devil distract you. Now, here's another one I want to catch you with. Don't ever let rejection stop you either. I'm going to preach in here today. See, I used to let rejection stop me.
I would apply for a job and they wouldn't give it to me. And I'd be like, oh, I ain't gonna never be nothing. I would apply for a credit card and they turn me down. Ain't got no church in here, amen, somebody? I would apply for a certain college and they would say, no, you ain't got the grades, amen? And I thought rejection meant that I had to stop. God says, son, rejection don't mean you gotta stop. Rejection is nothing more than redirection. Preach, Pastor Troy. I'm talking to somebody today. Rejection is nothing more than redirection. And you keep stopping every time you reject it. Sometimes rejection is a blessing in disguise. Oh, you don't want to clap, but I'm going to make you clap. Some of you were rejected and you thought you lost something. But as you look back 10 years later, you glad they rejected you. Amen. Some of y'all so glad you didn't marry somebody, you want to shout right now. But at the time, you thought you lost out. Your heart was broken and you, I'm in a lost out. Let me tell you something. Rejection sometimes is a blessing in disguise. Sometimes you get with folks and then they reject you. And then you walk around with your head down. You got to know you're the prize and you're the gift. And if they can't recognize that, they can kick rocks with no shoes on. What does that mean? I guess they got no protection for their feet. Amen. Who am I preaching to today that's got to learn how to interpret rejection? Some of y'all got to understand the only reason why you were rejected because you were dealing with folks that didn't know your value. Took me too long to figure this one out. Yeah, sometimes folk don't know your worth. Sometimes folk reject you because they can't control you. Sometimes folk reject you because they can't manipulate you. Sometimes folk reject you because you see the games they playing before the game even start. I just want to bless somebody to remind you that Jesus also was rejected. But here's the good news. He was backed by God. And because he was backed by God, no matter what the devil did to him, he always bounced back time and time again. Somebody say rejection is nothing more than redirection. Now, here's what God told me to tell somebody. Lean forward real quickly because I don't want this to get out. There's a secret now. Y'all don't tell nobody what I'm about to say. God told me to tell you to quit pouting and start pivoting. All right, you can sit on back. You can sit on back, not tilt. Sit on, lean back, amen. My boys don't dance. They just rock away, amen. Somebody lean back. Lean back. Come on, somebody. What'd you say, Pastor Troy? Quit pouting. Where's my church at? And start pivoting. Quit pouting. And start pivoting. I'm talking to you. Quit pouting and start pivoting. What are you telling me, Pastor? When you get to something, amen, that makes you want to pout, understand, the only thing God's trying to do is get you to turn, amen, somebody. Because when one door closes, God will open another one. I'm trying to stay calm, boy. It's hard for me today, man. I feel good because it took me way too long to figure this out, Eric, when one door closes, God will swing another one open. But coach, here's the problem. We so busy looking at the door that closed. We so busy crying, Marie, because the door closed that God said if you would just pivot, you would see I opened another door the same time. Good God Almighty. Who am I preaching to today that's got to stop pouting and you got to start pivoting? Give God praise if you got it. I got to go. God, that's good to me. In the words of the great evangelist, Mary J. Blige, hear me, no more tears, amen, and no more drama. Take that to your mama, amen, somebody. Y'all didn't know Mary was an evangelist. Some of you have cried way too much over foolish people. You got to get a new attitude. Say, I'm unstoppable. Yeah, you turn me down, but I'm unstoppable. That's why some folk can't stand me, because I got an unstoppable attitude. I put the unstoppable. You what? Come on, you better play with it, amen, somebody? I say, make them say, Nah. Y'all pray for your pastor. I need help. Okay. See, y'all millennials make me sick sometimes. All the millennials sitting here looking stupid. Come on, some. Look at the millennials. They're looking real dumb. I'm going to try it one more time, then I'm going to tell you, make them say, Nah. Okay, now let's educate the millennials. Back in the days when music was music. Back in the days where the rappers did more than mumble. It was some boys out of New Louisiana who went by the name of No Limit, amen, somebody. And they had a No Limit tank, amen. A fella named Master P, y'all gonna make me preach it here now, came up with a song and the hook say, make them say, Now when the devil says you're unstoppable, all you gotta do is say, unstoppable. I wish I had a church in here. Tell your neighbor, I am unstoppable. I like y'all today. Who am I preaching to? You gotta make the devil say, Millennials, go home and Google Master P. That's your homework. Say, Pastor, can I tell you something? Say, sometimes, if I can be honest, I get tired. Show of hands. Listen, ain't nothing wrong with that. Life will make you tired sometimes. Can I be 100 with y'all? People will make you tired sometimes. I don't want to look at nobody. Life will make you tired sometimes. Let me hit you with this one. Them jobs. And it ain't the work. It's the people you got to work. I was. Make you tired. You know you need a blessing when you got to pray before you walk in the building. Amen. Come on, come on. You know, when you sitting in the car 5 minutes, Lord. You in the parking lot. Father, I need your help today. Because if you don't guide me, I'm cussing everybody out today. I ain't got no real church. Amen, somebody. Here's what I need to tell you, though. When you get tired, learn how to rest and not quit. Come on, somebody. I'm at a place in my life where God is teaching me how to rest when I get tired and not quit. How to pull back a little bit. That means that sometimes you can't answer everybody's call. Sometimes folk will get mad. People get upset because they can't control your time. Let me tell you something. When you give all the time, you better take some time for yourself because folks ain't going to give it to you. I'm going to say it and keep moving because some of y'all ain't going to clap. There's always going to be somebody needs something, wants something, got to have something. But at some point in your life, you got to make yourself a priority. Because if you dead, you can't help nobody. If you dead, you can't help nobody if you dead. So sometimes you got to learn how to rest. And let me say this. You have to learn how to rest and not let people know you rest. Because people think because you rest and you got time for them. No! I'm resting. You can always tell the ones that's getting offended because they be the same ones saying, you know what, you should get some rest. Don't you kill yourself. We love you, Pastor. Get some rest, Pastor. And them be the same ones. How am I supposed to get rest if you keep bothering me? I'm losing my claps, y'all. It don't matter though, I'm gonna get that rest. See, here's what I'm teaching you. When you understand that you are unstoppable, then you don't have to be calling somebody all the time. Let me ask y'all a question. Who am I calling? Who am I calling? Who? It ain't you. So whoever I'm calling, I suggest. You ain't got to clap. I don't care no more. Tell your neighbor, learn how to rest. Now the reason why some of you ain't clapping because you have become a yes man and a yes woman. Some of you don't know how to tell nobody no. Then you say yes to everything and you wonder why you wore out. Sometimes you got to say, nope, not going to do it. No, I'm not going. No, I'm not able. No, I'm not willing. No, I'm not interested. Why? Because if you're going to be unstoppable, you can't do everything. Okay. Keep on saying yes. Then get mad with yourself for saying yes. Somebody say, I gotta learn how to rest. That's good teaching right there. Can I go deeper? How many of y'all ever get frustrated? Okay, when you get frustrated, catch this, learn how to regroup, not resign. See, when you're frustrated, the devil's trying to make you resign. I quit. I'm not going to do this. I'm going to back up. No. Just learn how to regroup. Those of us who have any level of success will tell you we had to regroup so many times in order to get there. Now, everybody that goes to college, it ain't easy for y'all. I know that y'all fool folks. Y'all do get your little graduation. Da, 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 and you walk around with your little cap. You done wrote something on the top and everybody see you smiling. But you don't tell folks how many times you almost quit. See, you don't tell us that. You don't tell us how many nights you scratched your head trying to figure out trigonometry when you can barely do 1 + 1 = 2. You don't tell nobody that. But every time you got to that place of frustration, you said, I just need to regroup. I need to regroup. I need to regroup. And because you regrouped over and over and over again, you wind up graduating. Some of you just need to regroup in this season and get your second win. Good God Almighty. I know the first quarter might have been rough for you. You get your second win, then you can run through the second quarter. Somebody say, I got to regroup and not resign. Tell your neighbor, when things don't go as planned, tell yourself, I put the un in unstoppable. Give God praise because I'm done just like that. Just like that. Are you done, Pastor?